We are at the 3 seeds. The end is nearing. As the 3rd seed in the East, I have the Atlanta Hawks. They finished last season as the number 1 seed in the East, where they won 60 games and lost 22. The best results the Hawks have had came in 1958, back when they were the St. Louis Hawks. Led by Bob Pettit, the Hawks won their only championship against the Boston Celtics in 6 games. Let's see the moves the Hawks made this summer. They signed their former draft picks in Walter Tavares and Lamar Patterson. Other players they got were Tiago Splitter, Tim Hardaway Jr. and Justin Holiday. Players they lost were Damari Carroll, Pero Antich and John Jenkins. The thing that stands out is that Damari Carroll is gone. He played great for the Hawks last year and was their primary wing defender. They'll miss him. Let's see how the rotation might possibly look like. At center there's Al Horford. He had a nice healthy season last year. He's then backed up by Tiago Splitter, who's a great signing. He'll give the Hawks more options. He's a very good role player, and the Hawks will be able to run pick and rolls with him. He'll also give them length that they needed last year in the playoffs, which I'm sure Al Horford is happy about. It can move Al to his natural position, the power forward. But I still expect Splitter to come off the bench. The two of them are backed up by Mike Muscala. At power forward there's Paul Millsap, who signed a new contract this summer. He'll be getting $20 million a year. He may be backed up by Mike Scott, who's facing drug charges and could face up to 25 years in jail. Not sure how those issues stand right now and how his season is gonna look like. Then at small forward there's Thabo Sefolosha, who will make his return after the NYPD broke his leg. They missed him in last year's playoffs. He could have been the second defender on LeBron in the conference finals. Instead, they put Paul Millsap on him. Thabo is a downgrade from Damari Carroll. He's not as good of a shooter. Backing up Thabo is Kent Bazemore. At shooting guard, there's Kyle Korver. He led the league in three-point percentage for the second season in a row. He shot a ridiculous 49% from three last year. He demanded so much attention from other teams. He's then backed up by Tim Hardaway Jr. Look forward to seeing him there. Then at point guard, there's Jeff Teague, who made his first All-Star team last season. He averaged 18 points and 7 assists. He's then backed up by Dennis Schroeder, who had a much improved season last year. He'll be able to give them a spark off the bench. I don't get why some people write this team off and put them outside of the top 4. Losing Damari Carroll is a loss, but they got Splitter and Hardaway to ease the blow of losing him. They also didn't lose any of their 4 All-Stars, so they will play the same style of basketball that got them 60 wins. And they were also 22-8 against the Western Conference, so they did well. The Hawks were 7th in defensive efficiency and offensive efficiency last year. This year they might fall back a bit on both categories, but they might stay put or improve on offense with the addition of Splitter and those options he will give them. To finish things off, I feel like they can absolutely be the number 1 seed in the East again. I mean, they will have the same system that worked last year, defend and shoot threes. I see a top 3 finish for them. If not, I'll be very surprised. On to the next team. As the 3rd seed in the West, I have the San Antonio Spurs. I feel like they won't care about the regular season, that they just want to keep the guys healthy for the playoffs. That's why I have them in the 3rd seed and not the top 2 seeds. They finished last season as the 6th seed, where they won 55 games and lost 27. They eventually lost in the first round to the Clippers in 7 games. The Spurs have won 5 NBA titles, last time in 2014 when they beat the Miami Heat. Let's see the moves the Spurs made this offseason. Players they got were LaMarcus Aldridge, David West, Ray McCallum, Jonathan Simmons and Boban Marjanovic. Players they lost were Tiago Splitter, Aaron Baines, Corey Joseph and Marco Bellinelli. The thing that stands out is that the Spurs had the best offseason in the NBA, by getting David West for nothing and then signing LaMarcus Aldridge. Let's see how the rotation might possibly look like. At center, there is Tim Duncan, who'll turn 40 in April this season. You wonder if this is his last season. He signed through 2017, so he could retire at 41, but we'll see how the PEDs hold him up. The burden he has carried will probably lean more on Aldridge now. At power forward, there's LaMarcus Aldridge, who had a good year in Portland last year. He averaged 23 points and 10 rebounds. Backing Duncan and Aldridge will be Boris Diaw and David West, a skilled veteran who can shoot and bring some needed toughness to the Spurs. He left $11 million on the table in Indiana to sign with the Spurs for the minimum. At small forward is the reigning Defensive Player of the Year, Kawhi Leonard. He got a bigger role last year. He averaged 16 points and 7 rebounds, along with leading the league in steals. Backing him up is Kyle Anderson, who only played 33 games last year. He could see some more time for them. At shooting guard, there's Danny Green. Backing him up is Manu Ginobili, who thought about retiring after last year, but decided to come back after the Spurs signed Aldridge and West. Then at point guard, there's Tony Parker. He'll turn 34 in May. He has not been convincing up late, both in last season with the Spurs and in the Eurobasket, where he disappeared at times. Unlike his usual self, his game may be on the way down. We'll see if he can turn things around. Backing him up would be Patty Mills, who should be healthy this year and could play a big role for the Spurs. Behind those two will be Ray McCallum. The Spurs have a great front court, and all those guys are interchangeable. You can go big and you can go small with West at center and Diao at power forward, so they have a lot of flexibility there. Only thing I question is if they have a hustle player in the front court, like a Robin Lopez type of guy that LaMarcus Aldridge played with in Portland. Those guys are good, maybe they don't need one. Then there's also the age factor. The average age in the front court will be 35 when the playoffs start. Will those guys hold up? It will be interesting to see, because they should be able to play off of each other. They also got the 7'3 Boban Marjanovic. I'm not sure if he'll get a ton of minutes, but he can give them a presence in spurts. The Spurs have a system that works, and I believe it will continue to do so. Coach Pop will get the best out of those guys, but their most important objective will be the same as the past few years, and that's to keep the guys healthy, from the front court to the back court. You don't know how much Manu will have in the tank. And then there's Tony Parker. I don't think the Spurs can win without Tony. To finish things off, I can see the Spurs anywhere from the 2nd seed to the 5th seed. They could get the number 1 seed, but I don't think they will. 2nd or 3rd is the most likely for me. They could make the NBA Finals and possibly win if they're healthy. They don't seem to be able to win back to back, and they didn't win last year, so that's in their favor this season. It will be fun to watch them in the West. That's it for now. Like, subscribe, and peace.